Thank you. Good afternoon. I think it's still afternoon. On behalf of the Washington College sponsors for this event, the Goldstein Program in Public Affairs, the William James Forum, the C.V. Starr Center for the Study of the American Experience, and the Center for the Environment and Society, as well as our community partner, the Sultana Projects Incorporated, I'm delighted to welcome you here this afternoon for the fourth in a series of events in the Washington College celebration of the International Year of Chemistry. I am Frank Cregan, and I serve as coordinator of the celebration. Perhaps if you've seen the posters around town, you were looking forward to seeing John Howard standing up here. So was I. John sends his apologies and his regrets, but he is bogged down in meetings with his editorial staff in discussions about the Republican presidential campaign. But John was to be here because this is very much a part of John's association with Washington College. Allow me to explain. When the United Nations proclaimed 2011 to be the International Year of Chemistry, it suggested that organizations and institutions around the world should provide opportunities for discussions about chemistry as it relates to society. Early on, we decided at Washington College that environment-related and energy-related issues would be the twin foci under the umbrella of climate change. So in late 2009, in the beginning of our planning stage, we settled on chemistry and climate change and politics and climate change as two topics for discussion and set about to find headline speakers. In the October 11th, 2010 issue of the New Yorker, I read Ryan Lizza's article, As the World Burns, How the Senate and the White House Missed Their Best Chance to Deal with Climate Change. And I knew we had our headliner. I contacted John Howard, the unofficial Washington College lobbyist in DC, to inquire about the possibility of Ryan Lizza as a speaker and John as our intermediary. John quickly replied, I know Ryan, I like him, and I admire his work. Let me get back to you. 3 hours later, John wrote back to say he had just bumped into Ryan on a platform at a train station in New York City and had the opportunity to discuss the offer to come to Washington College this fall, and Ryan expressed interest. Within 24 hours, I had a confirmatory note from Ryan. By then, he was in Germany with Secretary of State Clinton, but we were able to seal the deal, as it were. So, now about Ryan Lizza, our headliner. Ryan Lizza is Washington correspondent for the New Yorker and covers the 2012 presidential campaign as well as national politics. He joined the New Yorker after working at the New Republic, where he had been a correspondent from 1998 to 2007. He was formerly a correspondent for GQ and a contributing editor for New York. He has written for the New York Times, the Washington Monthly, and the Atlantic Monthly. He is a frequent contributor to political discussions on PBS and NPR. His recent articles in the New Yorker are profiles on President Barack Obama and the GOP presidential candidates Mitt Romney and Michelle Bachmann. Brian Williams of NBC Nightly News refers to Lizza as required reading for those interested in the American political scene. Conservative talk host Hugh Hewitt describes Ryan as one of the best political reporters working inside or outside the Beltway. He is regarded by many as a journalist's journalist. I'm pleased to present Ryan Lizza.
Thank you very much. That was extremely nice introduction. I want to thank Frank. I want to thank Washington College. I want to thank the Sultana Project for having me here. My wife and I love the Eastern Shore. It's sort of like a second home to us. My wife has family here, and we have two little boys who love nothing better than to come out here and see big sailing ships and you know, play at their grandfather's maritime museum over in St. Michael's. So it's I barely had to think about coming and doing this. So I really appreciate the opportunity. The title, of course, is Politics of Climate Change. And you know, I was joking with someone before. The emphasis here is going to be on the politics. I'm not your guy if you want to get into the science of this issue, but I have spent a lot of time looking at the recent history of how climate change went from being a bipartisan consensus issue to something that neither party really even wants to talk about anymore. And so a lot of the story I'm going to tell is it's a story about climate change and what happened to Obama's climate change legislation, but it's also the story of what's going on in Washington right now. It's the story of Obama's presidency and the difficulty of governing in the current environment. And so I'm going to leave a lot of time for Q&A, so I will be brief because I've heard other speakers have gotten in trouble for going too long and not getting to questions. So I want to start on January 19th, 2009. Barack Obama comes to Washington just days before his inauguration, and he travels to Chevy Chase, Maryland, to a dinner party at George Will's house. You all know who George Will is, right? Conservative columnist, has been writing for years. He's done this for other presidents. And George Will gathers a group of the leading conservative pundits writing today. Names you'd recognize. David Brooks was there, Charles Krauthammer, Bill Kristol, all the people who would end up being Obama's fiercest critics in later months. But this time it was the inauguration. It was a sort of kumbaya moment, and Obama wanted to go out of his way to reach out his hand to the opposition. And this was an off-the-record dinner. I wasn't there, of course, but some of the stories about the dinner have leaked out. And one of the big message that Obama had for this group of conservative opponents was he said that partisan as politics sometimes appears in America, the differences between the two parties really aren't that wide when you compare them to, say, European countries, which have parliaments where you might find communists and extreme right-wing parties sitting in the same body. And Obama went on to say that there was a good chance to forge consensus on a number of issues that were sort of ripe for compromise. He, you know, according to people I've talked to at this dinner, he impressed these guys. He made a powerful argument that maybe things weren't going to be so bitter and partisan in Washington, and that there was a real chance to forge some consensus. And if you think about it, he had reason to believe that. His three or four big domestic policy initiatives were healthcare reform. His healthcare reform was modeled on Republican Governor Mitt Romney's program in Massachusetts. So that didn't look like such a huge leap, you know, adopt a governor's Republican plan and try and apply it nationally. Until 2009, stimulus, the idea of stimulating the economy through fiscal policy in an economic downturn was not that controversial. Big arguments between Republicans and Democrats about what works as in terms of stimulus, tax cuts versus spending. But the theory, the Keynesian theory of stimulus was not incredibly controversial. Chance for consensus there. Immigration, Obama, Bush, McCain all had a similar immigration plan, although it was controversial with members on the right of the Republican Party. But plenty of Republicans who were in the ballpark of the Obama plan. And then global warming. This was arguably the most, this arguably had the most potential for bipartisanship. The debate at that point, 2009, seemed to be turning from the science to the politics, from the questions of whether global warming is happening to what should we do about it. In 2008, we had two presidential candidates, John McCain and Barack Obama, who essentially had the same approach to climate change, that is a cap and trade system. It was one of the issues that they agreed on more than any other. In fact, in 2008, there was a vote in the Senate. Did get a lot of attention at the time because people were paying attention to the presidential campaign. And seven Republicans in the Senate voted for a cap and trade plan. So the Obama White House had some reason for optimism. It wasn't totally crazy for him to come into George Will's house and say that this agenda had the makings of lots of bipartisan agreements. And just on cap and trade, remember the origins here. This was a policy that had its roots in conservative think tanks in Washington. The basic, for people who aren't familiar with the lingo here, cap and trade was the leading approach to global warming because it was seen as the conservative alternative to liberal command and control economics. The idea came out of the first Bush White House and was used to solve the acid rain problem. In other words, the first President Bush didn't like the Democratic ideas. He went to some conservatives and conservative think tanks, and they said, we have a great market-based solution here. We'll put a cap on pollution, and then the affected industries will be allowed to buy and sell permits to manage their own pollution, and gradually each year we'll lower that cap, and over time, these industries that are spewing out the pollution now will adjust and eventually, the problem will be solved. And that is exactly what happened with acid rain. And so as a senator and as a candidate, Obama embraced this policy. Famously, the night he sealed his victory over Hillary Clinton, he declared, "We will be able to look back and tell our children that this was the moment when the rise of the oceans began to slow and our planet began to heal." And so as we all know, Barack Obama did not slow the rise of the oceans. This policy died a year ago, a sort of quiet death in the United States Senate, and now almost no candidates, no Democrats, talk about cap and trade. So let's just quickly go through its life in Congress. So it passes the House. It passes the House 219 to 212, which looks pretty healthy, and gave a lot of people sort of false optimism about its route in the Senate. But in the numbers, there were some warning signs. For one, in the House of Representatives is a majoritarian institution. If you have a majority, you can pass your agenda. The minority has almost no rights in the House of Representatives. 25% of the votes in the House came from just two states, California and New York. So if you think about legislation that gets 25% of its votes from two liberal states, moving over into the Senate, California and New York only produce four votes in the United States Senate. So you could tell it was going to have a tough time over in the other chamber. And I think that one of the best stories about the House vote and showing how tough a road this was going to be later was what happened on the day of the vote with Ciro Rodriguez, a Texas Republican who had promised Nancy Pelosi and the other Democratic leaders that he would vote for this legislation. When it came time to vote, he ducked into the chamber, quickly cast his vote, and then sprinted out. He voted no. And as he was leaving the chamber, Anthony Weiner, you guys remember him, Brooklyn Democrat, chased after him yelling, "Ciro, Ciro, get back here." So that's how tough a vote it was, that people actually had to race in, vote, and leave. And this House vote represents the high water mark of government action on climate change, basically in U.S. history. This was the most ambitious proposal to deal with global warming that we've ever had, and everything was sort of downhill since then. In the Senate, despite a fairly valiant effort from Senators John Kerry, Lindsey Graham, and Joe Lieberman, the bill died a year later. So, and we'll get into some of the reasons why, but. So what explains the death of this policy? What explains the kumbaya moment Obama had in January to, by the time this fails, his approval rating has dropped, the Tea Party movement has exploded, his presidency is in serious trouble. So what explains all this? I think there are four important reasons why such an ambitious interventionist policy failed in the Obama era. And you could apply some of these lessons to many of Obama's policies, but certainly to something as ambitious as cap and trade. The first one, this gets talked a lot by pundits, but it's an issue of trust in government. A lot of political science recently about this variable of trust in government, and a lot of political scientists these days arguing that it has a lot of explanatory power. And if you look at a graph of trust in government, political scientists and pollsters have been asking whether the American public, whether they trust the government since the Eisenhower administration. And the first trust in government goes in the late 50s from almost 80%, that is 80% of the public saying they sometimes or always trust their government, starts plummeting, let me actually read this. So starting with the Johnson administration in Vietnam, starts going down, accelerates rapidly in the Nixon administration, as you might imagine, and right through the Ford and Carter years. So it plummets in that time period from Eisenhower to Carter from 80% to 25%. It made something of a comeback in the Reagan years, actually, climbing over 40% for most of his time in office. But then it plummeted again in George H.W. Bush's time in office, rose again with the good economic news in the Clinton years, and then dropped like a stone in George W. Bush's presidency. And it actually looked like it was on the upswing in early 2008 you can guess why. Maybe there's some optimism about the Bush era ending and a new president coming to power. But the bottom falls out of that number with the financial crisis in October of 2000, in the fall of 2008. And when Obama, on the eve of Obama's election, trust in government is at 17%, which is the lowest number ever recorded for that polling question. And so why does this matter? Why does it matter for cap and trade? For Democrats, more so than for Republicans, trust in government is essential. Trust in, just the quote from one pollster, Republicans, and this comes from some of the data, Republicans are more trusting of government when the GOP holds power than Democrats are when the Democrats are in charge. So when a Democrat takes power, trust in government drops sharply among Republicans, but the drop-off isn't balanced out by equal Democratic surge. So for instance, Democrats felt again, quoting Pew, Democrats felt far better about government under Nixon, Reagan, and Bush than Democrats did under Carter, Clinton, or Obama. So for a Democratic president, one, you have a huge drop-off because more Republicans are affected by this than Democrats. But number two, if you're a Democratic president, your policies rely on government intervention. So you are trapped in this death cycle of the public not trusting government, you're trying to use the government to implement your change, it backfiring and feeding on itself. And so this was the sort of vice that Obama enters office into, right? He has this massive agenda, healthcare, $800 billion stimulus. He has to deal with the bailout money that Bush didn't spend, and he has to transform the entire carbon-based economy with this cap and trade plan. So massive, massive government intervention at a time when trust in government is at its lowest level ever and the economy is plummeting. So the exact moment that economists will argue government intervention is needed across all of these fronts, the American people don't want it. I think that explains a lot of the problems that Obama's been having the last few years. You know, we saw this, let me move on here. So where's trust in government now? In September, CNN poll showed it at 15%, and this week CBS reported it at a new low, 10%, which is the lowest it's ever been. So when people don't trust the government, it's very hard to govern. The other factor, a major, major factor that obviously you can't ignore, that explain, and a lot of these factors obviously interact with each other in complicated ways, so you can't, it's hard to untangle them. But the economy, this is a very simple reason that ambitious environmental legislation addressing global warming hasn't passed. The economy sucks. And there's a good deal of political science to show that when the economy's bad, trust in government in recent decades rises and falls with the business cycle. They seem to go hand in hand. But for environmental legislation, this is an especially toxic cocktail, because there seems to be a strong link between a healthy economy and the success of environmental legislation. As Daniel Weiss of the Center for American Progress has pointed out, the first Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, the Endangered Species Act, they were all enacted when unemployment was 6% or lower. Unemployment has been over 9%, was over 9% for most of 2009 and 2010 when Obama was trying to pass cap and trade. And so no significant environmental laws has ever passed in our country when unemployment has been over 7.5%. And you could, the reasons, it's not hard to understand why. When people are suffering economically, worrying about far-off amorphous benefits from environmental legislation doesn't seem like a priority. When Obama was trying to pass cap and trade in 2000, I believe this poll is from January 2010, I could have the date wrong, Pew asked the American public what their top priorities were, and addressing global warming came in last out of about 24 issues, dead last. So not exactly the optimal environment to be pushing this legislation. Third factor that's made things quite difficult for legislating in the Obama era is a familiar one, political polarization. Since the late 40s, Congress has gradually become more and more polarized, with the parties slowly separating into two homogeneous blocks that are ideologically very, very far apart. And that trend's accelerated in recent decades. And when political polarization is quantified by political scientists, if you look at the graph, it just shows up as a line, you know, from 1978 to today, just zooming upward, unbroken upward line. And so there are a lot of explanations for why polarization has become, you know, more acute in the last few decades. And I'm not going to get into them all. They're very hotly debated among, you know, pundits and political scientists. Some people blame the media for feeding political polarization. Some argue that the effects of gerrymandering and redistricting are driving polarization because the House seats are redrawn to with politically homogenous groups. Doesn't totally hold up as a theory, because if you look at the Senate is also polarized, and of course there's no gerrymandering in the Senate. Others argue that primary elections, which have become more common in recent decades, make polarization more widespread, because congressmen and senators are constantly worrying about being primaried from their right or left. And then the sorting effects of Southern Democrats gradually becoming Republicans is a key explanation perhaps as well. One interesting thing, though, more recently, there's been a lot of work showing that political polarization and income inequality have risen and fallen together over the course of American history. And you don't hear much about this, but that is, to me, one. If you look at the correlation, it's absolutely striking. But whatever the causes, the result is a less activist federal government. Again, just like trust in government, if you are a Democratic president trying to use the power of the government to affect social change, polarization is going to be a more frustrating phenomenon for you than for a Republican, for a conservative president. If Congress is more gridlocked and less likely to produce bipartisan majorities necessary to solve a problem as difficult as climate change. We saw this after the House of Representatives passed their bill in 2009, when eight Republicans voted for it, and the faces of those eight Republicans were very quickly put on a poster, made to look like a wanted poster from the Old West, and was distributed, across a pretty popular poster on conservative websites on the internet, and it said, "Wanted in the United States of America for selling out taxpayers." So there's a lot of pressure, a lot of political pressure from Republicans to oppose Obama's agenda, no matter what the policy specifics. In the Senate, four Republicans who previously expressed support for cap and trade all abandoned the policy after they realized they would be challenged in a primary by a more conservative Republican. John McCain of Arizona, George Lemieux of Florida, Lisa Murkowski of Alaska, Lindsey Graham of South Carolina, who was, originally the author of the bill. They were all pressured from the right to abandon the policy. And in a polarized Congress where bucking your party, where there are costs to bucking your party leadership, in the current environment, you just don't see it very often. And it goes for both parties. And then the polarization also drove a major change in the way that Democrats and Republicans look at global warming. The views of Republicans and Democrats started to diverge in about 2005. Earlier this year, when Gallup asked voters whether they worry about global warming, 72% of Democrats said yes, and 31% of Republicans. So there's a 41-point gap between the two parties on this issue, whether they worry about it or not. There's a 45-point gap on the question of whether the seriousness of global warming is exaggerated in the news, with Republicans saying, 60% of Republicans saying it is, and 22% of Democrats saying it is. So it's become a partisan, polarized issue in a way that just 10 years it was not. Previously, climate change was strictly a regional issue. That is, if you were from a state that relied on a lot of coal or other energy source that would be affected by cap and trade, you were against it. If you were out in the Northwest where you used a lot of wind or hydro like they do in the Northwest, then you were for cap and trade because you wouldn't be as affected. But it changed from just a regional issue to a much more partisan issue. Between 2008 and 2011, the percentage of Americans saying that the effects of global warming had already begun dropped from 61% to 49%, which is the lowest point recorded in that poll. And almost all of that drop can be explained by conservative voters changing their mind about global warming. So Obama was trying to pass this legislation concurrently with a Republican Party that was completely abandoning the issue. And so to give you some idea about how intense the pressure was on Republican senators not to support the cap and trade bill, the day after Lindsey Graham announced his support for the legislation, he goes down to South Carolina to a town hall and is heckled and ridiculed by his constituents for supporting this legislation. You can find this clip on YouTube. I highly recommend it. One of his constituents yelled, "You're a traitor, Mr. Graham. You've betrayed this nation and you've betrayed this state." That was the kind of intense pressure that Republicans were facing on this legislation once it had become a serious partisan issue. And the final trend that affected this legislation, and it won't be a surprise to any of you, is the power of special interests in Washington. And we've really had a sort of almost laboratory-like conditions in Washington to study how special interests affect policy. Because Obama's agenda has affected so many segments of the economy, with healthcare, some 20% of the economy, with cap and trade, the oil industry, the electric utility industry, and heavy manufacturing are all majorly affected by it. So as you can imagine, there was quite a bit of lobbying on all of these issues. I got a chance to watch the process up close with cap and trade. And the way it works in Washington is you can't pass legislation affecting powerful interests anymore without their permission. So there may have been some halcyon past that we've all read about where, you know, presidents busted trusts and used the bully pulpit to beat powerful industries into submission. That's really not how it works anymore. For example, healthcare reform was the result of basically deals the White House made with the insurance and pharmaceutical industries. And I don't say this as a criticism. This was the only way to pass the legislation. One of my favorite stories that really brings this home is when Joe Lieberman went to lobby Evan Bayh, senator from Indiana, on cap and trade. Evan Bayh sat there with a map of his state, and it had a picture of all the coal-fired plants in his state. And as one of the people in the room said, every time Joe Lieberman would open his mouth, Bayh would just show him that map. That was it. That was the end of the discussion. And so when the three senators that were putting this bill together, they realized because of how polarized the Senate was, because no Republicans would support it, they realized they changed their strategy from getting the senators to agree to the legislation to getting the outside interest groups to agree to the legislation. It's a major change in the strategy as this bill was working its way for the Senate. And almost all of the important negotiating on the details of the legislation was conducted with industry, not with other senators. The idea was that once the oil companies and the nuclear industry and other interests agreed to it, they would actually lobby our elected senators to back it. And so among the architects of the bill, the strategy was called, if you build it, they will come. And so I'll give you one example of how this worked. T. Boone Pickens, who's a Texas oil and gas billionaire, he endorsed the bill after literally writing language into it that would have given his industry enormous federal subsidies. And you know, this was a feature, not a bug. If T. Boone Pickens, a major Republican who spent a lot of money defeating John Kerry in 2004, and it was Kerry who went to him with this deal. I love this because the staffers working on the bill, their joke on this was, what do you call a climate bill that gives Pickens everything he ever dreamed of? And of course, the answer is a boondoggle. T. Boone Pickens. At one point, they actually cut a deal with the oil companies. Here's how it worked. Kerry, Graham, and Lieberman sat down with the oil companies, and they reached a compromise where they would support the oil company's preferred policy preference on one very difficult issue if the oil companies would stop lobbying against the bill and stop running negative TV ads against the bill for 6 weeks. So that is an example of how legislating works in Washington. You are going to the industries and giving them something so they will stop attacking your legislation and lobbying your current your fellow senators. And in the end, it wasn't enough. So where does that leave us today? In the realm of both science and politics, the momentum has been completely reversed. I said before we had moved from science to politics. Well, on both scores, things have reversed. Congress these days has been very aggressively trying to take away the powers of the Environmental Protection Agency, which now has the authority on its own to regulate greenhouse gas emissions in the absence of this legislation. The White House barely talks about climate change anymore. I did a search when I was preparing this. I couldn't find Obama mentioning the words unless he was specifically asked about it since this legislation died. And on the Republican side, we've seen a major, major change since 2008 when their presidential candidate backed a cap and trade plan. National Journal recently put it this way: the GOP is stampeding toward an absolutist rejection of climate science that appears unmatched among major political parties around the globe. So this is now a major litmus test for all Republicans. It's as important as defining yourself as a member of that party, or it's as important as being against legalized abortion or tax cuts if you're a Republican now. And we are now the only industrial democracy with a major party that does not accept the scientific consensus on climate change. And you just have to read some of the comments from the current crop of Republican candidates to get a sense of how far the issue has moved since 2008 and 2009, when Obama was so optimistic about this. Herman Cain recently said, "Man-made global warming is poppycock. In other words, I don't believe in it. If people look at the real data, the climate has varied ever since we've known that the planet was here." Rick Perry: "I do not think that the concern of international warming," he calls it international warming, "has been politicized. I believe there are a significant range of scientists who have manipulated the data so that they will have dollars rolling into their projects." Michelle Bachmann, in a very famous speech, famous to people who pay attention to this stuff, she said, on the floor of the U.S. House during the cap and trade debate, she said, "Carbon dioxide is a natural byproduct of nature," which is true. "Carbon dioxide is natural, it occurs on Earth. It is part of the regular life cycle of Earth. In fact, life on planet Earth can't even exist without carbon dioxide." She goes on and on, long pain to carbon dioxide. Ron Paul has called global warming, quote, "the greatest hoax." And only John Huntsman has been fairly consistent on this issue. Although Mitt Romney has said this: "I believe the world is getting warmer, and I believe that humans have contributed to that." It was a huge, huge deal when he said that earlier this year. It was major news that a Republican candidate made a statement like that. But at other times, he sounded a little bit more like a skeptic, including in his book, No Apology. But Huntsman and Romney have been the two candidates that have been willing to stand up to their party on this. Of course, John Huntsman is barely registering in the polls. But it'll be interesting to watch. Romney looks like the front runner now. It looks like the likely nominee. It'll be interesting to watch how he navigates the issue. But you can understand why. I mean, there's a poll of Iowa Republicans from August. "Do you believe in global warming or not?" Yes, this is just straight up, "Do you believe in global warming?" Yes, 21%, no, 66%. And Obama, unless he's specifically asked about it, he no longer mentions it. And just to end on a slightly depressing note, at least if you care about this issue, since cap and trade died, the EPA is charged with regulating it now. Well, the entire community of people who follow this issue has been waiting, because today or tomorrow the EPA was supposed to announce its schedule for regulations on power plants for the next year. And I got an email from someone who follows this issue, talked to someone in the administration, email this morning, and if this person is correct, the word is that the White House is not, as previously planned, going to announce any regulations to curb greenhouse gases for power plants. So that just gives you a sense of how we go from Obama, talking about in his one of the biggest speeches of the campaign, how he was going to stop the rising of the seas, to actually telling his own EPA no, not, you know, don't regulate this this pollutant. So I hope I've educated you a little bit and not depressed you. I didn't mean to end on such a dour note. But let's open it up to questions.
There are microphones here in both aisles. There's also a microphone up there in the balcony. It would probably be best in this atmosphere if you came forward to ask your question. This way you're standing when you ask your question. Ryan certainly can hear the question, so please.
You see if you can hear from here. Okay. You've done a marvelous tour de force of politics and climate change domestically, but there's a whole world out there.
Yeah.
Can you shed some light on what other countries have been doing in the meantime?
Oh, I mean, the rest of the world is moving forward without us. I mean, Bill Clinton was recently asked about this dynamic in the U.S., and, you know, his comment was, we look like a joke. Even the countries that we had a certain right to be suspicious of when Kyoto was going through the Senate, China, India, there was an argument to be made that, well, why should the U.S. Curb its emissions so severely when these countries are not? Even that argument is tough to make now because they're aggressively going forward. You know, the only bright spot is that now that it's two things. One, you know, from there is always, things change very fast in politics. Just as 2008 to 2011, this issue turned on a dime, it can turn back. And I mean, the perfect storm for this policy just might be a Republican president, a Democratic Congress, and a really healthy economy. You could imagine that scenario with the right president and enough pressure from Congress and a healthy enough economy where the public was cared about the issue again. You could see things turning back. But internationally, most developed nations are going forward with some kind of cap and trade regimes. I mean, the irony from the Europeans, you talk to Europeans about this and it drives them nuts because they hated cap and trade. And so the U.S. said, no, you got to go with cap and trade. It's the only thing we can pass in the U.S. It has to be a market-based conservative policy. And they feel like there was a little bit of a bait and switch because the Europeans adopted cap and trade, and now in America, cap and trade is considered a heretical idea among conservatives. So, but there is, some, you know, Canada, there are some regional cap and trade programs in the U.S. Huntsman joined one when he was governor. There's a regional agreement in the Northeast. There's one in Canada, and there is some discussion of these regional cap and trade initiatives linking up and trading permits with each other. And you'd have a sort of, you know, maybe if that worked, you could show the federal government that this isn't such a disaster, and you could widen the program out to other states. That's the sort of optimistic view. But when the U.S., I forget the statistic, but the contribution from the U.S., you can't solve global warming without the U.S. Our contribution of greenhouse gases is too high. And so I had one, when I was preparing this week and just talking to people and figuring out what the latest was, one person said they came back from a meeting of environmentalists this week, and the most optimistic scenario was, maybe Obama can pass it in his lame duck session after he loses this year. So,
is this on? Thanks. You mentioned that the distrust of government has prevented any legislation. So now that we see a movement in which we're expressing our distrust of large corporations, how do you think that will affect the conversation, and in particular with respect to EPA's ability to regulate?
You know, it's interesting. There is one caveat with the trust in government data. In 2009, there was a lot of polling that showed a favorable disposition towards regulating big business. That was a popular position in 2009. Not that surprising, given the economic crisis. So, you know, voters often have you know, contradictory views on these things. But I don't know. The Occupy Wall Street and this movement, it could peter out, or it could be the beginning of something akin to the Tea Party on the left. But I do think that Obama probably missed a moment in 2009 when he had a lot of political capital, and he missed a moment to sort of address the aggravation that a lot of people had after the financial collapse in a more, you know, confrontational way. Now, he was being advised by his Treasury Department that our whole strategy here is to prop up the banks. We need confidence. We need the bankers and the public to be confident in our financial institutions. That's what's going to get them healthy again, and then they'll start borrowing, and people will start building businesses again, and you'll have this virtuous cycle. So all the advice he was getting was, don't attack the banks. Don't attack industry. These are the people. If anything, you should be doing the opposite. So we'll debate for many years whether, you know, he missed an important moment there. And one thing I just want to add is, I don't want to leave any people with the impression that the cap and trade legislation was some perfect piece of legislation. It was deeply flawed in many ways. And mostly what I'm trying to get across here is the macro political factors that make it extremely difficult to enact ambitious legislation in Washington today. And, you know, some people would argue that that's the way it's supposed to be. That's the way the founders set up the system. So we shouldn't be all that surprised.
And what I find particularly interesting is that our legislation is totally determined and dominated by the two political parties. The most important vote in presidential elections is the independent vote. It's why Obama was elected and why he'll get elected again, or not get elected again, whichever the case may be. And yet no one's talking to the independent. And we have both, in my judgment, radical wings dominating legislation. And a lot of sane people in the middle, frankly, are feeling as frustrated as anybody, because no one seems to be addressing issues that affect us.
Yeah, the independents, we talk about independents as if they are a unified block of voters with an ideologically homogenous view of the world, and they're not. Independents are all over the place. And it makes it very hard to craft policies that appeal to so-called independents. Because first of all, many independents aren't really independents. They're hardcore Democrats and hardcore Republicans who just like calling themselves independents. And if pollsters, you know, when you press, I forget the percentages, but when you press a lot of independents on who they vote for, who they voted for in the last 10 elections, it's usually one party or another. So you can sort those people out and just sort of lump them in the camps with the two parties. But then there is this sort of hardcore, difficult to define, what we sometimes call the moderates, but you look at the data, and sometimes they don't have that moderate. They don't actually have moderate views on certain things. But I take your point. They're extremely important in settling elections. And if you look at 2008 when Obama won the independent vote, and you look at 2010 when the Republicans won the independent vote, this group of voters shifted some, I think, 25 or 30 points from one direction to another. So when you have a group of voters deciding elections that swings wildly over the course of 2 years, it makes politics really unstable. And it's the Obama White House has been obsessed from day one with independence, and right now he's struggling with them. And given 10% trust in government and the approval rating of Washington, Congress has an approval rating in single digits, which is unheard of. And John McCain famously, his joke about this is, congressmen are down to paid staffers and blood relatives. And it's absolutely true. So there are a lot, like Tom Friedman, a lot of smart pundits are arguing that the political system is ripe for a third party movement, that one is inevitable in 2012. And I don't know. I don't know the answer to that, if that's true or not. But it's, you know, if I were a very wealthy, independent-minded, person, it wouldn't be a bad investment right now. And you see people like Mayor Bloomberg, or or at least people that like him, toying with the idea or trying to push him into it. I think next year would be a perfect moment.
Hi, the Department of Defense has a very aggressive program related to climate change. Undersecretary Robine has established the highest target for lowering under Obama's executive order. Army Corps of Engineers has done modeling, and the Navy has an admiral that's out speaking to every possible community, public and national group they can. Do you think that's getting political support? Is that being done quietly? How is that happening?
It's been true for a long time that the military is often one of the most progressive institutions in American society. I mean, if you look at the way the military racially integrated before a lot of American society, it's an amazing success story. And a lot of smart national security thinkers have written about the global challenge of climate change and how that's going to affect America. When island nations start sinking, and when population and we start experiencing massive movements of refugees in places like Africa and elsewhere that the models show will be disproportionately affected by climate change, America's going to be dragged into that situation. So there are a lot of people in the military, a lot of national security thinkers who believe this is a crisis around the corner that are concerned about it. And yeah, there's been a lot of thinking just in trying to move to alternative energies in the military. But of course, it's the military. You can just say, do it, and it gets done. Our political process isn't like that. But they're definitely ahead of a lot of people in Washington on this. Yeah. I mean, I should say one thing. There is an important debate among some Republicans. My view of this is global warming's never going to get addressed in the U.S. unless you have two parties that agree on the science, right? I mean, it's just not going to happen. And there is a debate among... There's three camps of non-believers in the Republican Party on this. There's, the outright denialists, right, who just deny that the science is accurate at all. The sort of pure denialism, right, that the Earth is not warming. And then there's the skeptics, that the Earth is probably warming, but you can't tell if it's man-made, so we shouldn't adopt some big expensive policy to address this if we're not positive. And then you have the sort of fatalists who just say the Earth is warming. It's because of man, but there's no way to do anything about it without destroying our economy. So we shouldn't really try, and perhaps we should just move into mitigating the effects. And it's interesting. There's a lot more action in that third camp than in the pure denialism camp. So.
But
yeah. Yeah, I use them interchangeably, but it's just PR. I think actually now some environmentalists don't like climate change anymore. But part of the move was, it's not just that the Earth is warming, it's that the climate is changing in all sorts of ways, right? In some parts of the world, it will get colder. There will be more precipitation. The effects of climate change are varied. So I think that was the thinking, at least among environmentalists, in moving to that phrase. Anyone else in the back?
Yeah. Protections and specifically the EPA becoming the Republican Party right now?
That's absolutely right. The EPA is one of those government agencies that on the campaign trail among Republicans is constantly mentioned as something that needs to be, you know, depending on the candidate, its power taken away, defunded. Some have gone so far as to say, you know, just get rid of the whole EPA. And if the, you know, if the plenty of economists who believe we're in for, you know, a decade of high unemployment, and you're right, then you wouldn't really see the prospects for strong environmental regulation coming back. All the action in Congress right now is to take away EPA's authority. EPA, I didn't make this clear before, but the EPA has the legal authority to address greenhouse gas emissions. As I said at the end, they were just about to pull the trigger on using that authority, and apparently, we'll see in the coming days if this pans out, if this is true, apparently they've decided not to because it's simply too controversial in an election year to do it. But look, yeah, you're absolutely right. I was trying to come up with the most optimistic scenario. I don't believe that's the most likely scenario by any stretch of the imagination. Anyone else?
I have been very intrigued by what you have to say, and I think you have many graphs and statistics and a lot of research to back it up. But I can't avoid the impression that you are looking at the shiny surface of things. And what I mean by that is that I, as a former unfrocked physicist now, who has a great affection for the sciences, I can't avoid the impression that we have suffered tremendous casualties because of the amount of institutional denial. There are too many people who have been unfunded, inadequately funded, punitively transferred, had the conclusions of their studies rewritten on orders from high. And I think that to a certain extent we are reliving a Galilean moment. There's no Galileo that we can pin on to pull out that martyr and gin up people's indignation at this. But I think we should be indignant about what has happened to American science because of this institutional denial. And I'd love to see you warm up what you're saying and get away from the cold, hard facts and statistics and talk a little bit about the people who have had their careers wrecked and how American science has lost a lot of ground. We didn't do the bold experiment with the neutrino. We are going to check it, of course, but Europe and other nations seem to be better positioned for science than we are.
Yeah. Well, no, it's an excellent point. It's an excellent point. And, you know, I think it is part of a larger trend in institution after institution in American society becoming under attack by the partisans. It happened in academia. One of the most common phrases on the campaign trail is to, you know, mock people who work in the academy, right? And once climate change became a partisan issue, well, the target inevitably becomes the scientists who are arguing that this is real. And what sounds like you maybe even personally experienced is you're in the crosshairs of political battle because the issue that you and others work on has become politicized. A lot of scientists I know are not used to that kind of combat, right? And one of the leading incidents that happened alongside the decline in American support for climate change legislation was the so-called scandal in the UK, the hacking scandal. And those scientists were, you know, unfairly attacked, but it bred a lot of skepticism about the science. And I think most scientists are not really equipped to engage in sort of the political combat that people in Washington are involved with every day. And when you have a very well-funded opposition, the folks that are affected by cap-and-trade legislation spread a lot of money around to sow doubts about the science. And in that sense, it's a sort of unfair battle when you have industry, which is very politically sophisticated, can hire the best consultants and lobbyists, going against a scientific community who is empirical, who is looking at things empirically and not based on political outcomes. So I take your point. I hope that warmed things up a little bit, but it's a very useful thing to add to the discussion.
Okay, so at this point, I think before we thank Ryan, I want to put a plug in for an event next week at Washington College, next Thursday, 5 o'clock, Jackson Theater. A scientist of some repute, Mario Bellina, Nobel Prize winner, 1995 in chemistry, will deliver a lecture on chemistry and climate change. He has some robust data.
Uh-oh.
That he is more than willing to share with people. So I invite you to sort of reconvene, if you will, next Thursday at Washington College in the Gibson Center for the Arts, Decker Theater. And please now, let's thank Ryan Lizza.
Thank you all very much. I really appreciate it. Thanks.